In this example of an inquiry-based lab, we're going to be hearing from an instructor and a couple of students in a second semester biological sciences lab taught at Vanderbilt. The students in this lab have previously taken a biological sciences lab and at least one chemistry lab. So while they may not be biological sciences majors, they've made some commitment to studying science. The lab in which these students are enrolled is an alternative to the standard second semester biological sciences lab, and it's characterized by a semester-long directed research project and an emphasis on experimental design and analysis. In this lab, groups of eight students are partnered with an instructor, usually a TA. The group reads papers on a particular topic to provide background and to help them think about open questions in the area. With the guidance of their instructor, they choose a question and design one or more experiments to answer it. Mid-semester, they give an oral progress report to the other students and instructors in the course, giving their results to that point and talking about how they're going to modify their project for the second half of the semester, which culminates with a public poster session to which all the biological sciences faculty are invited. As you watch the upcoming video, I encourage you to think about the skills the students and the instructor have to employ in this project.
So we read different papers that tested the methodological, chemical, and sociological aspects of hand washing, but there wasn't any literature on how effective different drying methods were in reducing the transfer of bacteria. So we decided to test five different common drying methods in reducing, or in their efficacy in reducing bacterial transfer, and found that there is a significant difference, or that time and the drying method used do make a significant difference in reducing bacterial transfer.
How to research, how to do their own experiment, that's the real goal set that we have. That's the real skill set that I want them to learn, is to be able to think critically about, okay, you've got this great idea, now find out, will this work? How can we do it? Let's get some results. And now, what do these results mean, and how can I apply it into the real world? When you leave this class and this school, you're going to be out there in the world helping to make decisions, helping to do things. We want them to be able to just figure out, not only for themselves, but for others around them, what works and what doesn't work. It's really the journey, not the actual end process here. My role is primarily, one, to help them get the ball rolling, essentially, to, specific for this project, choose some ideas, choose some papers that will help them learn about the problem or the possible avenues they could explore more thoroughly, and just kind of let them have time to internalize it and to talk about it. We have a few group discussions where they'll have time to debate amongst the various papers that they read. There's no one right way for this. It's just the idea that I wanted to present them with the base knowledge that they could then decide, okay, what could we do and what's an interesting idea for us to investigate and explore?
We started this semester working with just hand washing in general. It's something that's been interesting people for a while now, with hygiene and health, of course. What kind of caught our group's attention was the idea of germ transfer when your hands are wet versus when your hands are dry. So, for instance, if I walked in the bathroom and washed my hands really clean, if I touch the doorknob and my hands are still pretty wet, there will be approximately 100 times more germs transferred to my hands than if my hands were bone dry. We had something called journal club, so everybody came in, presented their paper, what they thought was interesting about their paper. This is all to try to work toward a question, so this is all part of the process sent up by Charles and Dr. Biscow.
The challenge is designing the experiment, and how will you go about testing this out? What methods will you use for the eight students that I have? How will their limited sample size affect them, and how will they go about to try to improve that?
So he's been very good, and he's always there for questions about statistics or anything to do with scientific experiments, which Charles has a great deal of knowledge in compared to myself, for instance. So Charles, but he's not a teacher in the strict sense of the pedagogics. Here I am teaching you, you are here to learn from me. It's more of a guidance sort of thing, with Charles kind of, I don't want to say being the captain, but kind of making sure we're staying on the general right track.
rapport discussion is one where you're in a circle and you as a teacher are essentially the major spoke in the wheel, the wagon wheel. And it's you say something, the student responds. You talk to another student, the student responds to you. It should be the students being interactive, a web together that they are working collectively. So initially it's always me getting the ball rolling. As time progresses, I would hope that they start to, via the little activities I set up and do, that they collaborate a little bit and they debate amongst themselves, well, I liked this paper that we read because of this. Well, I did not like this paper because of this aspect. So it's taking the time to notice, okay, when in the discussion do you need to step in and referee? When do you need to step back and let them work it out? And when do you need to be a tiebreaker, essentially, to be someone to, okay, it's a great point you're making, but it's probably not going to work because of X reason. It's always good for students to have some ability to learn something that's unknown. They're so used to there is a right answer. Well, in reality, especially in science, that's not the case. I try to go through and troubleshoot ahead of time to, like, are certain ideas feasible enough? But I never try to go through and do the experiment myself, meaning for this one, for past ones, I've not spent weeks doing trials over and over again. I've kind of investigated ideas, tried a few things. Yes, this can work, but I try to step back and let them do all the hiccups. There's times in the past where for projects, different one than this one, what some students worked on was totally unfeasible. And I wasn't sure if it worked or not, but I didn't think it would. But I still let them go through it because it's the journey that they're needing in this case. I want them to make the map of their education, not me hand them this map that they're following. In our particular setup, we had them as a checkpoint to how well they do in their experiments. We do a mid-semester presentation. The original goal was to do a pre-trial to kind of test proof of concept for the experiments they're designing. And the semester presentation is a reality check, as we call it, that, okay, now you must present your results. And for many students, it's the first time to also think about presenting publicly in a coherent fashion what they're doing, what they did, and how it relates to the real world. So after they spend their whole semester working on their ideas, can you show the world, not just the class, what you've learned and what you've done? So we'll have them make a large poster, which we've gone to the format of us printing it at cost, for them to present in a sort of a mimic of a real scientific conference. We'll just set up a lab area somewhere or a lobby area where they can all as a group set up and take turns with people walking by randomly that will go, what they did to this random person.
I think it's better in the sense that we work on something we want to work on. I have a couple friends that are computer engineers, and they said Google, I think it's Google, is one of the most productive companies because they let people work 50% on what they're supposed to and then have 50% to work on whatever they want. So these are happier, more productive, more efficient people. So here we are in bio, we have a project doing what we want. I think we've done a lot of work.
Well, there are two ways that TAs benefit from participating in the inquiry-based lab over their normal experience in the regular non-inquiry lab. Their roles are improved in two sorts of ways. One is as a teacher and also as a research mentor. In their role as a teacher, they are getting some practice in higher order sorts of skills, such as planning and troubleshooting, things that they don't normally get to do in the regular class. In the regular class, they may just be grading papers or answering questions, things like that. In terms of as a research mentor, they have to figure out what the requirements of their project system are. They have to select papers that they want the students to read. They have to plan for the materials that they're going to need to have for that project. So there's a number of things that they get experience with that they don't normally do in the regular non-research-based class.
So here we saw another example of inquiry-based lab pedagogy. In this case, the projects are longer and more involved and require more collaboration among the students. Again, I want you to think about the ways that this lab differs from a traditional lab and the ways it is similar to a traditional lab. And again, how does this approach mimic what we think of as real science?